من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ياسين والقرآن الحكيم إنك لمن المرسلين على صراط مستقيم تنزيل العزيز الرحيم لتنذر قوما ما أنذر آباؤهم فهم غافلون لقد حق القول على أكثرهم فهم لا يؤمنون إنا جعلنا في أعناقهم أغلالا فهي على الأذقان فهم مقمعون وجعلنا من بين أيديهم سدا ومن خلفهم سدا فغشيناهم فهم لا يبصرون وسواء عليهم أنذرتهم أم لم تنذرهم لا يؤمنون صدق الله العلي العظيم For Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم
Nosotros creemos de que la memoria de Hugo Chavez y su espíritu no está muerto.
Tonight we are here to remember and not think of Hugo Chavez as his spirit is gone, but he's still with us.
Un hombre que pudo desde sus inicios en la política tener una mentalidad de unidad en un maravilloso pueblo como el pueblo venezolano.
A man that since his beginnings he's had the unity of his people.
Pudo tener la mentalidad de ayudar a un pueblo maravilloso como el pueblo venezolano.
A man that wanted to help and to bring up a beautiful country and people as the Venezuelan people.
Sin importar la mentalidad ni la religión de la cual viniera.
To him, it did not matter what mentality or religion they believed in.
Yo conozco que él ayudó a la iglesia cristiana.
He helped the Christian church.
Las excelentes relaciones con la iglesia islámica, con los grupos islámicos.
He had an excellent relationship with the Islamic people.
Y hoy podemos ver a una nación venezolana llorando la muerte de un gran líder.
And today we see a united Venezuelan nation crying over the death of their leader.
Yo como colombiano,
myself like a Colombian,
entiendo de que sus relaciones con los demás países, en especial con este, no fueron buenas.
I understand that his relationships with many countries, especially this one, were not so well.
Pero lo que hizo en su propia nación,
but what he did in his own nation,
y las relaciones que estableció con otros pueblos,
and the relationships he established with other nations,
hicieron que el pasado viernes 32 jefes de estado estuvieran presentes en Caracas.
Caused 32 heads of nations to be at his in Caracas, Venezuela, for him.
Y que hoy millones de personas estén lamentando su fallecimiento.
And that today millions of people are mourning his death.
¿De qué estoy hablando?
What am I talking about?
Estoy hablando de un legado.
I'm talking about a legacy.
Realmente murió muy joven, a los 58 años.
He died very young, 52 years.
Pero lo que hizo,
but what he did,
más de lo que dijo,
more than what he said,
quedará grabado en la historia de Venezuela.
Will forever be in Venezuela's history.
Por eso es importante que cada cosa que hacemos durante el día,
because that's why it's very important that everything we do during our day,
deje una huella tan importante,
that it leaves a mark,
que las generaciones puedan hablar de eso.
That generations after us will talk about it.
Cada uno de los que estamos acá tenemos una oportunidad.
Each and every one of us has an opportunity
de marcar una diferencia.
To make a difference.
No solamente con lo que decimos,
not just with what we say,
sino con lo que nosotros hacemos.
But what we do.
En nuestra iglesia cristiana,
in our Christian church,
nosotros creemos,
we believe,
de que cada día es una excelente oportunidad,
that every day is an excellent opportunity,
para ayudar a la persona que está con nosotros,
to help our neighbor.
Así que no importa,
so it doesn't matter,
a qué iglesia nosotros vayamos,
what church we go to,
o el pensamiento bueno o malo que tengamos de Hugo Chávez,
or our bad or good thoughts that we have of Mr. Chávez,
podemos aprender hoy una gran lección.
We can learn one good lesson today.
Es estar dispuestos,
and that is to be willing,
a dejar un legado,
leave a legacy,
a que después que nosotros nos vayamos,
so once we are gone,
la gente pueda decir,
people can say,
esa persona,
that person,
sembró una semilla,
planted a seed,
de amor en nosotros,
of love in us.
Muchísimas gracias.
Thank you very much.
Types of people that have a lot of money. So
what we do is we got this box and we go around and I'm not trying to ask for money right now. I'm going to do that later. But we get this box, and at the end of the event, people usually enjoy the event, and we say, hey, you know, whatever you got, we got food, we got this room, we got plane tickets. If you can pitch in a dollar, a quarter, $100, whatever you can, we'll take it. And almost 9 times out of 10, we don't make enough for the event. So what I end up doing is I get my box, and I go to the local mosque, and I stand outside of the mosque, and I just hustle for the money. And sometimes it takes 3 months. Sometimes it takes 1 month. So, sometimes it takes a while, and then after we get the money, we still do it, and we try to have money in case tragedy like this happens. We'll have money to have the event. So anyway, as a lot of y'all might know, our main speaker that we invite, his name's Imam Abdul Alim Musa. He's a great speaker. Minister Jeffrey's been on the podium with him before. So we sit there with, like I said, with all this hardships to get the money that we do. We get him I gotta ask the brothers, but something around a $500-$600 plane ticket. And he goes to the airport. They don't let him get on the plane. He gets there, whatever, 1 hour, 1 hour and a half before he's supposed to get on. They don't let him get on the plane. Well, what they do first, they harass him. Okay, you know, this guy's been on a plane, you know, seriously, maybe 300 times after 9/11. Maybe even more. Because he travels once a month. Count that for 10, 11 years, however long it's been. Think about how much it is. Sometimes he travels every week. So he's been on a plane 200-300 times. They, you know, takes them an hour, hour and a half. They wait, and they do this on purpose. They wait till the right exact moment. They let you go, and then you get there, and the plane's still there, but they close the door, and they don't let you get in. You know, and they sit there, and they, okay, well, you got to go get another plane ticket. Well, y'all the one that helped me up. What do you mean you got to go pay $300, whatever, late fee, or whatever the hell it's called? And he paid $285, and again, they didn't let him get on the next plane. And this has happened to me several times, okay? So anyway, that's how our group works. And what I want to know is, what are they so scared of? You know, what are they so scared of? Well, what would happen if he would come to this event? He would speak, if their system is as good as they say it is, mm-hmm. Why wouldn't you just let him come and speak? Mm. Nothing would happen, because your system, you believe and you say, is better than all other systems. You would have nothing to worry about. But you know, and we know, and everybody knows that it isn't. And the world is ready for a change. Why would there be the need for all these snitches that they got everywhere? That they use with our tax money. Our tax money. You can't go into a meeting without 4 or 5 people and there'll be a snitch there. In every mosque in this city, in every mosque, in every city in this country. And not just this country, in all the countries in the world. How come they don't have the same problems that we do in the mosques that they do in the churches? Because in every mosque there's a snitch, and there's not just one snitch. I could go, I mean, Mr. Jeffrey probably can do the same thing. You could go and be with a group of people for a week and figure out who the snitches are, just by the way they act. They're always trying to cause fights. No, really.
Go ahead.
Yeah, that's what they are. There'd be no need for this. There'd be no need for their lies in the media. There'd be no lies for it. There'd be no need for it. All the lies, you know, this is my new way of figuring out. This is a new trick that everybody can find out about who's if there's a president in a certain country that you don't know if it's good or not. All you got to do is see if the media is saying something bad about them. If they're saying something bad about them, they're good. I promise you. The media, probably from the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, I'm not sure, but the media, the most powerful entity on earth, they have the power to make the guilty look innocent, and that's power. because they control the minds of the masses. There's a quote from Imam Khomeini, rahmatullah alayh, because after the revolution, they come up to him and say, oh, you know, the American media, they don't like you, and they're saying bad things about the revolution, and this and that. And Imam Khomeini said, I thank God that they say these things about it. I worry when they don't say bad things about us. It's good when they say something bad about us, because then we know we're on the right path. And again, like I was saying, what are they so scared of? If there's not a doubt in my mind, and I bet you the majority of the people here probably believe the same thing. There was no need. Hugo Chavez was 58 years old. He was a military guy. You're saying 53, but I think I could have sworn it was 58. It's 58, right? Yeah, it was 58, yeah. No, it's 58. He's 58, military guy, good shape. You know, he got a little chubby towards the end here, but before that, he was always in real good shape. You know, there is no way that he just got some random cancer and died in a year and a half. There's no way. So, this continues. What are they so scared of? If your system is superior, there'd be nothing to be worried about. You would say, look, there'd be no reason to have these billions and billions of dollars spent in Latin America against him. And what he would do in response was he'd be helping people in New York. I got a message that I hope we can read. It's from the rabbis in these anti-Zionist rabbis that Mr. Farrakhan's met with before. They're great people. They were telling us about how they would help people, the poor people of New York. Think about what they've done in South America when they're helping people in New York. And now they say these dumb things like, oh, there's poor people in Venezuela. Well, there's a lot less poor people now than there was in 1990. I'll guarantee you that. Okay? And there's poor people in every country, in every city in the world. To those people, they could come with us and we could show them how many poor people are here in Dallas. Mm-hmm. You know, that they don't give a damn about, but they're worried about the people in Caracas for some reason. So, like I said, if they have nothing to worry about, what's with all this billions of dollars spending against the Chavismo movement? Why would you do a coup in Honduras? An American coup in Honduras. If your system is better than theirs, there's no need to do that. No, you would say, hey, our system's better, and we're going to mind our own business, and if people in Honduras or Bolivia or Nicaragua or wherever else, they want to have a Chavismo-type government, let them have it. But they know that they're worried that it has spread through Latin America, and it will continue to spread through Latin America. I have another quote from Imam Khomeini, rahmatullahi alayhi. He said, kill us, you will make us stronger. Kill us, you will make our beliefs stronger, and you will show who you are. Mm-hmm. And by doing this, they've made all the revolutionaries stronger. I sure feel stronger. They made our beliefs stronger. They're going to make the Chavismo movement stronger. It's not, I mean, on March 5th, I know a lot of people here were upset and crying and stuff like that, but what they do, like they always do, it's going to backfire in their face, like it always does. When they killed Brother Malcolm, and they killed Brother Malcolm. Nobody else, there's no reason to blame other groups about it. They're the ones that killed Brother Malcolm. When they killed Brother Malcolm, they thought that, okay, well, we'll just knock him off, you know? But by doing this, they made him to this day. To this day, people read, know about Malcolm X, they know about his story, they read his books, and they believe in his message. And the same thing will happen with the Chavismo movement. It's going to, inshallah, spread through Latin America, and it's going to end up at their doorsteps in Brownsville and Laredo, and it's going to spread all around the world. Thank you. our next speaker is our good friend Dan Sullivan.
Hugo Chavez was born on July 27th of 1954 in a small city in Venezuela as to a family of school teachers. He had a career in the military, reaching the relatively unimpressive rank of lieutenant colonel. He died on March 5th of this year in the military hospital in Caracas. His funeral, as has already been mentioned, was attended by 32 sitting heads of state and 6 former heads of state. His body was accompanied to the viewing by a procession which numbered surely in the hundreds of thousands of ordinary working Venezuelans, but which was led by the Vice President of Venezuela and the President of neighboring Bolivia. These numbers are interesting in a sense. I believe they create a world record. When John Kennedy died, 19 heads of state attended his funeral. When Ronald Reagan died, it was in the 20s. I don't believe as many heads of state have ever attended a funeral as attended Hugo Chavez's funeral. So how did this person, from these humble beginnings, reach this stature? And I should stop to mention, he's mourned in Venezuela by the march. He's mourned by these heads of state, but he's mourned by ordinary people around the world. People in this room, this may be the only meeting like this in Texas, but it's not the only one in the United States by any means. I know of meetings in Chicago. I know of a meeting in New York. And there are meetings in London and across the world, ordinary people mourning this man. How did he reach this stature to be perhaps the most mourned person of our lifetime? We could look for the answer in his personal qualities, and there are personal qualities there which are impressive and well worthy of emulation. Hugo Chavez was a brilliant man. He was an excellent communicator. Anyone who's seen him speak will appreciate his use of timing, his use of gesture, and so on. His program, Hello Presidente, was an innovation in television. In this program, he would take a camera with him to wherever he went, to the slums of Caracas, to a cabinet meeting, whatever else, making the Venezuelan presidency and the process of governing Venezuela open to any Venezuelan who had a television. This is a new thing and an invention of his, and an indication of brilliance and talent. That was one thing which he had, was brilliance and talent. He had also dedication to the people, love of the people. He saw it, I think, in a large sense, in a Christian way, the commandment of Jesus to love one another, or perhaps the beatitude that says, blessed are they who hunger and thirst for righteousness. And this was the center of his life. That was one of his attributes. He risked his life in 1992 in a coup attempt in order to prevent a massacre which was then ongoing in the slums of Caracas. He risked his life for that, and that was out of love for the people. So that set him apart. He had other attributes as well that set him apart. He had determination and optimism. In 2002, there was an American-backed coup in Venezuela. It began with months of protests and a strike by the executives in the oil industry and so on, which seriously damaged the Venezuelan economy. It proceeded to daily marches through Caracas with people calling for his blood. It was backed by all the main powers in the world, especially the United States. And it culminated in military officers arriving at the presidential palace in Venezuela with tanks demanding his surrender. Now, at this point, many people would probably have given up. This is a hopeless situation. You're surrounded by the enemy, and you're going to be taken prisoner or you're going to be killed. But Hugo Chavez had optimism enough to see through that. And so instead of giving up, he played for time, played for time, played for time, and eventually, through the intervention of the people, the coup collapsed. We can name other attributes that Hugo Chavez had on a personal level, and they are impressive. But they alone are not impressive enough to explain the stature that he has in the world. There are many people who are impressive. There are many people who are wonderful people. We probably know some who live very obscure lives, perhaps a grandmother in a working class neighborhood. They do not get mourned in the way that Hugo Chavez has been mourned. The reason that Hugo Chavez has reached the stature that he has in the world is because of what has been accomplished by his government. And what that is, in concrete terms, is a significant improvement in the lives of ordinary Venezuelans. Millions of Venezuelans have access to health care, housing, decent food, who never have before in their lives. The Barrio Adentro program has brought doctors, it's brought dentists, And it's been done under the control of the local communities. This is criticized in the world press as giving the oil money to the people, but I've often thought that was a very hollow criticism, because it seems to me that if the oil belongs to Venezuela, right, then it belongs to the Venezuelan people.
Right. Yeah. Right.
This is the economic side of the transformation that he's wrought in Venezuela, but there's a political side to it as well. These programs are not administered entirely by central government bureaucrats. They are largely administered by neighborhood committees made up of ordinary working class people. I have the honor to have a friend who's in one of these communities. She's an ordinary person who under any other government would have been treated as no one of any importance. She's capable, she's charismatic, she's concerned about her people, and in Venezuela today, that allows her to have a role in governing her neighborhood and in making her country work. So how has Hugo Chavez accomplished these things? We know essentially the political biography that he has, or I think we do. In the 1980s, while he was a military officer, he was stationed in an area where there had been Marxist guerrillas. He came across a burned out car, which apparently had been used by the guerrilla movement, and found within it a stash of Marxist literature. He began reading it, and that was his political awakening, or so he said. He formed a movement inside the army, a secret society of Bolivarian, as he called it, officers. In 1992, in reaction to government massacre of under the government of Carlos Andres Pastrana, of citizens of Caracas and the poorer neighborhoods, they attempted a coup. The coup failed very quickly. It collapsed. He went to prison. He was released. He started the Fifth Republic movement. Within a couple of years, he had been elected president of Venezuela. He oversaw the writing of a new constitution for Venezuela. He ran for president again and again, winning again and again, often by more than 60% of the vote. When he ran for the first time, when he was elected president for the first time, it spelled in a very real way the end of the Venezuelan political order. Like the United States, for many years, Venezuela had had two competing political parties, which were, in effect, two sides of the same coin. One might be a little more liberal, one might be a little more conservative, but essentially, they were very, very close to one another. And from the moment that he began his campaign for president, that conflict, that show conflict, which was the conflict in Venezuelan politics for many years, no longer mattered. It was irrelevant. It was wiped off the board. And the question now was Chavez or no Chavez. So how did he accomplish all this? Yes, he had these qualities that I've mentioned. Yes, he was an impressive person, but no one person can do these things. It wasn't Hugo Chavez who did these things. He led the way, he showed the way, but it was the Venezuelan people who did these things. Hugo Chavez, the single most important moment of Hugo Chavez's life, in my view, was in 1992 when he attempted that coup d'etat. Because at that time, the Venezuelan system had for many, many years been rotting from within. And it had reached a point where it was just about ready to collapse. And this one single blow, not even a very hard blow, never had a real chance of conquering the government, was enough to begin that process of collapse from which the system would never recover. I don't mean to say that that's the end of his contributions. He led the process through, and another leader might have done much worse with it. There are, as I say, very few people who were as effective as communicators. There were questions of timing, how fast or how slow to move in the process of change. There was the process of building unity. All these things he led the way in, and he made major contributions. But the most important thing he did was set the process moving, because the people only needed that spark for the fire to take off. So now Hugo Chavez is gone. And there are people in Miami who are cheering that. It is a sick thing to cheer. It's a sick thing to cheer your enemy. Even if it's a bad person, it's a sick thing to cheer them. I remember in Angola, when Jonas Savimbi was on his last legs and the Angolan government was about to hunt him down and finish him off, and he was a war criminal who had been on the CIA payroll for decades and all this, and the president of Angola said, "We don't want to kill him. We want him to surrender and resume his place in the peace process, or go to prison or go into exile. But if he leaves us no choice, then we'll kill him." that's a humane view of it. These people are not humane. They don't have a humane view of it. They never had a humane view of Chavez because they never viewed him as a human. But these people are cheering his death partly out of hatred and partly out of the belief that the death of Chavez is the end of their troubles. But they could not be more wrong. They could not be more wrong because Chavez didn't do this. He led it. He showed the way. But the people of Venezuela did this. And the people of Venezuela are not going anywhere. And it wasn't the people of Venezuela alone. It was the people of Venezuela with their allies in Cuba, in Bolivia, in Iran, around the world, even here, who did this. And we are all still here. We are not going anywhere. Their troubles are not over. Their troubles have only begun.
They sent it to two people. They sent it to the new president of Venezuela, and they sent it to us. And they asked me if I could read it at the event because we invited them. We invite anti-Zionist revolutionaries to our events usually. So they asked, we've had many events with them throughout the years. So they asked me to read this, and Irfan's bringing it up on the computer, and it's going to be ready in a second. So just give me a moment. We have Minister Jeffrey Mohammed will be speaking shortly. So just give us a second. Do you want to give us the speak first? It's going to take a little bit? Okay. Well, be speaking on the behalf of Minister Louis Farrakhan. Please welcome Brother Jeffrey Mohammed.
Assalamu alaikum. In the name of Allah, the Beneficent, the Merciful, the One God, to whom all praise is due, sender of all prophets, revealer of all divine scripture, we thank him for Moses and the Torah. We thank him for Jesus and the Gospel. We thank him for Muhammad and the Holy Quran. May the peace and blessings of Allah be upon all of his worthy servants. I thank him for raising the most honorable Elijah Muhammad, and I am forever grateful and thankful to Allah for blessing me in this day and time with a beloved leader and teacher, such a wonderful man who is a freedom fighter, has the courage to stand and speak truth to power without fear of any consequences. And that man is my leader and teacher, the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan. So I greet you all once again in the greeting words of peace, of Assalamu alaikum. Peace be unto you. I want to simply begin by reading a statement issued by the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan, who has been traveling throughout South and Central America, the Caribbean. He has been on a tour there. He recently spoke in Belize in a 4 or 5 day trip to Belize, where he spoke at the universities there. And then he went and visited the central prison, where he spoke to the prisoners. And then he spoke to the nation via television, saying words to the government, words of encouragement and words that would help that nation to move forward as well. And so what I want to read is a statement from the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan that I believe will be printed in our next issue of the Final Call newspaper on our brother Comandante Hugo Chavez. And it reads, "I am honored to be back in Belize. And I wanted to start tonight by offering some words of thanksgiving for the life of Hugo Chavez, the late president of Venezuela. Hugo Chavez was a great, great patriot and a great servant of the masses of the people. He was so strong in his desire for the masses of the people of Venezuela to partake of the wealth of Venezuela that he earned the wrath of the oligarchs who ruled Venezuela and the government of the United States of America and others who seem to be negative whenever somebody rises for the mass poor of the nation. Hugo Chavez is a man that comes once, maybe, in 100 years. But I would like to say to the people of Venezuela and to all those who benefited from the charitable behavior of President Hugo Chavez, there's a verse in the Quran that goes like this: speak not of those who die or are slain in the way of God as dead. They are alive, but you perceive not. Those who work, who attempt what the Quran calls the uphill road, to free a slave, to raise a man who is languishing in the dust, that is the uphill road. And Hugo Chavez traveled that road and lifted the poor of his nation, sharing the oil wealth of that nation with the poor, with those who were locked out, with those who were servant class for the rich. The poor in Belize need to be raised. The poor in Central America need to be raised. The poor of the Caribbean need to be raised. The poor of America need to be raised. The poor of Africa need to be raised. The poor of the world need to be raised. For it is on the backs of the poor that the rich have become so powerful. So whenever God raises somebody that speaks to the poor and raises the consciousness of the poor, the governments that have sucked the lifeblood of the poor hate such a man. And unfortunately, sometimes they are so powerful, they control the media, and they use the media to demonize a strong black and brown people who work for the mass poor. These are the words from the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan, and I say as those before me have already said, we don't see him as dead. We see a man like Hugo Chavez as one born from the people who represents the flesh and blood manifestation, yearning, and longing of that people to be free, and that cannot be killed. And that does not die until it reaches its end. So men like Hugo Chavez and the many others, like our brother who was murdered by the American government, Muammar Gaddafi,
like Fidel Castro, who works for the poor. We see these men as men who follow in the footsteps of Jesus, who worked for the poor. And I see here in America, called the greatest nation on earth, who has great political power in the world, who has great military prowess, but who is losing her economic leverage and is becoming morally bankrupt as a nation. In the midst of this government that has done so much evil, I see a man like Hugo Chavez in the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan, who is willing to stand and speak the truth to power without any regard for his own life. And this is what Hugo Chavez did. And this is why we should love men like that. I know we are Muslims, but we like to quote the Bible. And the scripture says, no greater love has any man than he would lay down his life for his brother. So we thank God for the life of Hugo Chavez and all of those who fight for freedom, justice, and equality, and for the total liberation of the people. May Allah be pleased with him, and may Allah be pleased with all those who fight in the cause of truth. As-salamu alaykum.
You or not to bury you. The thing I would like to talk about is some of the things we've all been reading by way of epitaphs and by speculation of what will happen now if Chavez is dead, and then I'd like to circle back around through some information I hope will be of some practical use, because I'm not as eloquent as those who can inspire. But you, besides that, you don't need me to tell you what a wonderful man Chavez was, or to tell you how important it is that we carry on the work, because all of you already know that, except for the snitches, and I'm not going to get through to them anyway. But what I would like to address first is the speculation that now that Hugo's gone, the movement has to die. And I think that it's important for us to remember that there was a movement before there was a Hugo, and he led it, but the people made it possible. And what I would like, well, maybe forgive me if I lied a little bit, by way of inspiration, is say that we all are Hugo Chavez. And if we're not, we're in trouble, because the movement is not one man, and it never was one man. Now, I've worried a lot about what's going to happen in Cuba when Fidel dies, because my friends in Cuba, who I've enjoyed spending many a time with, and many a daiquiri, is they sometimes seem to think that he's a more than human figure, and that their troubles are all taken care of because of this great father figure. And that's not the way it works. And that's not the way it works in Cuba either. I've come to think that it's going to be fine after all. But we have to watch out for trying to put our expectations in one individual instead of recognizing that when an individual is speaking truth to power, leading us, is telling the masses what they need to hear in a way that is convincing, then we need to give this person our support, recognize though that we are appendages of that person. We the people are also that person, and will continue to be after his physical body is dead. Now, looking back around to the practical, my field before I went into law was journalism, and I would like to talk a little bit about the mass psychology of persuasion, and hope that this may be of use to you at some point. We all know that Hugo Chavez was a nut, in a coup, and we know that because everybody knows it. And what everybody knows is something that you have to be crazy to doubt, and none of us wants to be thought crazy. So the most important, the most effective way of silencing us is to marginalize us and make us afraid to be called conspiracy theorists or afraid to be called truthers and so forth, because it's not respectable. So how did this come about in the first place? Well, because at one point people were talking about who was Chavez. They're talking about what little they know, and what they got from the same sources, the media, which are completely controlled in this country by the same oligarchy that tried to stage the coup against Chavez in Venezuela, and that slaughtered thousands of people in Libya, and is now trying to slaughter people in Syria in order to establish their eternal rule of the banking elite, which I won't digress too far into. But the gist of it is that people, at a point, they've never heard of Hugo Chavez. And this is just an example, but I think Hugo's a great example, too, because you go out on the street, people are going to tell you, well, he was a nut. Well, how did they know that? That's what they saw on TV. That's what the media told them. Well, did they sit down across the table with coffee with a friend? Yeah, well, you see that on TV? They reinforce the same notion. It's kind of like a church where people get together and they say the most outlandish things that not one of them could possibly believe on his own. and they all are afraid to contradict it, and they all go home and they say, yeah, I believe this. This is pretty much the mechanism. There are other sophistications like and details like twisting language, getting people to use terms like terrorist to have almost no literal meaning, but have a great emotional impact. But I won't go into that right now because it's not time. But I think what the point I would like to make is that you have to have the courage to inquire on your own. You have to have the courage to let them think you're crazy. Because, as C. Wright Mills said, the common sense is more often common than sense. So, I hope this will be useful when you're talking to other people. If you can inspire them to have the courage to doubt what everybody knows, then I think our movement will continue to grow even faster than it's growing now. And it is growing now simply because of economic misery that our oligarchy is imposing on those. One other point I would like to make, and I just disagree slightly with some of the other speakers, although this is the only point on which I have any reservations at all. I don't know how useful it is to talk about the oppression that we suffer as being perpetrated by the government of the United States or any government. The ruling elite is international. The International Monetary Fund is international. The Bank of England, the Rothschild fortune, is international. The ruling class does not respect any national boundaries. The bombers who slaughtered people in Libya were from all over Europe and the United States. As long as they can make us think that we are separate from other people by national boundaries, they can keep us divided. They can tell us that the most important thing in our political life today is to keep the Mexicans from coming up across the river. You know, because we're superior. Because we're God's chosen people, and as such, we have the right to steal land and murder other people. This is superstitious nonsense. Superstitious nonsense. And so I want to ask you to join me, and I know you are already ahead of me, most of you, in becoming Hugo Chavez. Each one of you has to be Hugo Chavez. I have to be Hugo Chavez. We each have to be the person with the courage to speak and the person with the incentive and the gumption to reach out to our brothers and sisters, and not just the ones that we already agree with. It's great for me to be talking to you because we all agree, but it's not getting us as far as when each of us goes out and begins to spread the word. And so I think we have a whole room full of Hugo Chavez's, and I would just like to conclude by saying, Hugo Chavez, presente.
Okay, I'd like to thank everybody for coming tonight. We had a great crowd, but with the way that things are changing in the world, we can put this on YouTube and send this out to our friends and stuff, and everybody can see what we did here tonight. So again, thank you for coming. I'd like to thank Minister Jeffrey for coming, all the other revolutionary groups for coming, Dan Sullivan, Danae, Erfan, everybody, thank you. Thank you.